بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. It's great honor to share in this critical care course online. First of all, I want to introduce myself. My name is Dr. Mohsen Salah Abdel Azim Mahmoud. I am a professor of critical care medicine in Cairo University in Egypt. And currently I am working as a critical care consultant in the cardiac critical care unit in King Fahd Military Medical Complex. My subject today will be the acute heart failure management in the era of COVID-19 pandemic. I wrap in this slide a lot of references and the guidelines for anybody who is interested to get more information and more data concerning the presented subject, so he can go through this links and he can get directly the this paper, so he can infer any data whatever he like. The subject for discussion in this presentation, we are dealing with four items. First, the spotlight of COVID-19 and heart failure, the heart failure classification and subtypes, acute heart failure management, and a small brief about the cardiogenic shock outlines. A acute heart failure is a life-threatening medical condition where urgent diagnostic and therapeutic tools are of key importance. Recent guidelines from many societies have provided updated recommendations on acute heart failure management. However, there is still lack of evidence in many fields of management tools, and the physician frequently have to make a decisions based on expert opinion consensus, rather than evidence-based. The WHO declared COVID-19 as a pandemic on March 11, 2020. Today, there is a pressing need to flatten the curve and reduce its exponential growth and understand its impact on the special populations, and especially those with a chronic disease. Patients with cardiovascular disease are considered to be at a notably higher risk of protracting COVID-19 infection and developing complications. Moreover, the virus and its proposed therapeutic solution themselves result in cardiac complication, inclusive but not limited to the myocarditis, arrhythmia, and myocardial infarctions. Additionally, the healthcare provider looking after this particular of high-risk group of patients are at risk of protracting this illness. The aim is to establish a consensus on how to mitigate the risks enlisted above, which are associated with this pandemic, and advise a clear pathway to manage the acute heart failure patients. With high demand for the critical care bed during the pandemic, the action plan should be directed to decrease ICU admission and rapid effective management of acutely decompensated heart failure patients with shorter ICU stay. Safety is the first. Safety for healthcare provided at a time of pandemic is a top priority. Due to some overlap of presentation of either acute decompensated heart failure and the COVID-19 presentation, therefore, evaluating heart failure patient, the risk of COVID-19 must be assessed by using COVID-19 score form for acute respiratory illness. Patient with acute decompensated heart failure will automatically be scored at a high risk. The patient should be treated with airborne precautions, and personal protective equipment should be on site. It is also encouraged that these patients are all empirically swabbed and tested for COVID-19. And all healthcare providers should always wear this protective, personal protective equipment during their handling and managing of this type of. The heart failure, either to be acute or chronic, the patient urgency for an emergency department visit, for possible ICU admission or need to be seen in the clinic, should be performed based on the criteria endorsed by the Saudi Heart Association in collaboration with the Saudi Safety Society. This implemented in 2020, the criteria had been enlisted below. And this criteria may working on three items: the time frame for the patient to be seen and admitted, the nature of the disease or the nature of the clinical presentation of the patient, and the priority, which is divided to four type of priority. Priority 1, 2, 3, 4. The time frame, the patient to be seen and admitted within 24 hours, especially for the unstable patients. And teach it to the stable patient with de novo heart failure, which is a priority number 4, where this patient can be seen within the 30 days. As the recommendation for the emergency department and the inpatient management, the heart failure, as we mentioned before, categorized according to their presentation. In other way, the acute heart failure with unstable hemodynamics or pulmonary edema should be managed accordingly to the standard of care with protective, personal protective equipment for a COVID-19 in place with ICU admission. The acute heart failure with a relatively hemodynamically stable patient with just volume overload and the patient is in NEHA class 2 to 3 can be managed with extra dose of diuretics IV and the patient to be referred to cardiology team based on their priority from 1 to 4 as we mentioned before. The discharge from the emergency department should be individualized as per patient if the following criteria is present. There is no deterioration in the hemodynamics. There is no symptomatic hypotension after rebolus of diuretics. Significant good response to diuretic treatment, pouring good amount of urine within 2 hours, more than 500 cc, and more than 1 liter within 6 hours. There is no evidence of hyponatremia. There is no concomitant non-cardiac acute illness or causing of decompensation like evidence of any sepsis, and they ensure that post discharge follow-up plan including secure the management consideration for the hospitalized patient with heart failure. All patients should be tested for COVID-19. For patient admitted with acute decompensated heart failure should be admitted to the critical care unit in a negative pressure room if it is available with personal protective equipment till the PCR of COVID-19 had been released negative. It is also encouraged to actively early discharge planning for this type of patient to ensure that patients are discharged as soon as possible to reduce the risk of the complication and to save the critical care beds. Patient with acute decompensation who PCR tested positive for COVID-19 must always be handled with an airborne precautions. Co-treatment with COVID-19 targeted therapy should be in alignment with the national guidelines and performed acceptable protocols. With consideration for drug-drug interaction and the cardiotoxicities that should be taken into consideration, and kindly refer to the international guidelines which had been approved for management of acute or chronic heart failure and hemodynamic management and assessment. There is special population should be considered. It has been reported that cardiomyopathy, 25% of the patient with significant respiratory symptoms have been associated with the COVID-19 to develop this heart failure. This was more common than a complication like acute kidney injury. and yielding a worse prognosis with much higher mortality. This was due to secondary to myocarditis, stress cardiomyopathy, or a potential reactivation or pre-existing asymptomatic left ventricular dysfunction or initiating active coronary artery disease through coronary thrombosis. There is no significant recommendation on different treatment in this particular group. For another group of patients which are so sick, that patient for transplant. Patient enlisted for heart transplantation or post-heart transplant status are the most vulnerable heart failure population in the current pandemic. The International Heart and Lung Transplant Society recommend managing heart transplant patient who develop COVID-19 based on the severity of its illness, with the consideration of the national protocol for COVID-19 and the guidelines. The classification of the patient based on the symptoms between mild, moderate, and severe. Mild should be admitted for observation and follow-up with no changes in the immunosuppression. Moderate symptoms, the patient should be admitted to the cardiac critical care unit under observation and CT scan and chest imaging and full lab profile including D-dimer, CBC, and C-reactive protein and kidney profile, and the treatment is done with collaboration with the infectious disease and critical care physician. With the severe symptoms, the patient should be admitted to the cardiac critical care units. Mechanical ventilation will be considered as part of line of treatment, and the tools of mechanical ventilation, this an entity which going we discuss it in full detail in some lectures in this course. It will be presented by our colleagues. Also, the CT scan and chest imaging by ultrasound is and the considered treatment as per ID recommendation in collaboration with the cardiac critical care physician based on the national protocol. For the moderate and severe symptoms, add a concomitant antibacterial with antifungal treatment as this type of patient are prone for this infection if it is highly suspected. The immunosuppression for a moderate case, the mycophenolate should be discontinued, while in severe cases, all immunosuppression should be discontinued apart from steroids, which may require increasing its doses. Both in consideration, drug-drug interaction, especially that being used in COVID-19 protocol, especially hydroxychloroquine in combination with azithromycin, which have a so deleterious effect in cardiac arrest and QT prolongation. So close observation, frequent daily ECG with QT assessment. This one carry the handling better care for this type of patients. This represent the first part of the second part is the acute heart failure. We have to know that all guidelines define the heart failure as a complex clinical syndrome in which patient have a typical symptoms and sign result from an abnormality of the cardiac structure or function, which impair the ability of the ventricle to fill or to eject the blood. Acute heart failure is a rapid onset process of acute worsening of symptoms and or signs of heart failure associated with elevated plasma level of natriuretic peptide. It requires immediate medical management and usually urgent hospital admission. Acute heart failure be first occurrence of a de novo or more frequently acute decompensation of chronic heart failure, which call it acute decompensated heart failure. The de novo acute heart failure is mainly caused by the primary cardiac dysfunction, mainly acute coronary syndrome, while the acute decompensated heart failure may be precipitating by infection or uncontrolled blood pressure, rhythm disorder, or non-compliance to the offering drugs or non-compliance to diet and salt restriction. These slides contain different etiologies for the heart failure in all. And just I rabbit here, there is more common and less common. And the most common causes of heart failure in its terms, either to be heart failure with reduced ejection fraction or heart failure with preserved ejection fraction, is the tachyarrhythmia or coronary artery disease, which is the most common, or valvular heart disease, or left ventricular hypertrophy second to hypertension or obstructive valve disease. The most important is this is coronary artery disease, which manifested as a significant coronary artery disease or acute coronary syndrome, and can precipitated many of the different forms of heart failure. Other rare causes including exposure to toxic material like chemotherapy leading to direct myocardial damage, or postpartum, like postpartum cardiomyopathy, postviral infection, metabolic disorder, or infiltrative disease, like in case of amyloid or sarcoid, the sarcoidosis. All this is leading to different form of heart failure. And the most common causes of heart failure that we face it in a practical stages is the dilated cardiomyopathy, idiopathic and ischemic heart disease, and valvular heart disease, and related to hypertension. This is very important to know. The general classification of heart failure, we have five items. Based on it, we can classify the heart failure, either based on the ejection fraction, or the time course, or the functional status, or based on the clinical progression, and the most important, based on hemodynamic status, what we call it acute decompensated heart failure or acute heart failure. The classification based on the ejection fraction, we have either heart failure with reduced ejection fraction or heart failure with preserved ejection fraction, and in between heart failure with mid-range ejection fraction. This is based on number. If we have ejection fraction less than 40, this means heart failure with reduced ejection fraction. If it is above 50 or equal 50, this is heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. And in between 40 to 49, this would call it heart failure with mid-range ejection fraction. Another classification based on the time course. This is based on the European Society 2016 guideline, declassified patient of heart failure based on the time course of their heart failure. From asymptomatic with LV dysfunction, that this patient may have a reduced ejection fraction but never had been a symptom and signs of heart failure. Or patient presented by chronic heart failure when the patient had heart failure for some times, or when the patient diagnosed to be chronic stable heart failure, which had been treated, patient with symptom and sign are unchanged for the last 1 month, this will call it a chronic stable heart failure. While decompensated heart failure, we can be categorized for if the chronic stable heart failure start to deteriorate and may happen suddenly or slowly, and often leading to the hospital admission and even an event of the considerable prognostic importance. The new onset, or what we call it de novo heart failure, which can be presented acutely, usually in a sequence of acute coronary syndrome, or could be gradually in progressive deterioration of the left ventricular function as a case of dilated cardiomyopathy idiopathic pattern. Another classification, which is according to the guideline, the classified patient with heart failure based on the severity of their symptoms and physical activity, what we call it the New York Heart Association Functional Classification, NEHA classification. Symptom severity correlate poorly with many measures of left ventricular function, although there is a clear relationship between the severity of symptom and survival. Patients with mild symptoms may still have an increasing risk of hospitalization and death. Of classification based on the clinical progression. According to the American College and the Heart Association, the guideline classifies patients with heart failure based on the development and progression of heart failure. This stage provides a complementary information to the NEHA classification regarding the severity of heart failure. And finally, according to the degree of decompensation of hemodynamics or based on the hemodynamic status, what we call it acute decompensated heart failure, and this is classifying the hospitalized patient on their hemodynamic status, including the degree of congestion and the pattern of perfusion, and we are going to discuss in full detail later. This will transmit us to the acute heart failure. The acute heart failure considered as primary cardiac syndrome, it may lead to systemic disorder and affect all vital organs due to insufficient systemic perfusion and low cardiac output with or without venous back pressure. Acute heart failure may present with various clinical phenotypes such as acute pulmonary edema, hypertensive heart failure, cardiogenic shock, or organ dysfunction. The pathophysiology of acute heart failure is an integration between the pathophysiological changes in the neurohormonal based factors and perfusion defect based factor. As we see in this slide, the primary myocardial injury initiates activation of neurohormonal pathway mediated initially by sympathetic activation with activation of the renin-angiotensin system and escalation of the level of the endothelin level with marked elevation of the atrial natriuretic peptide and the Bro B related to increase of the increased intramyocardial pressure, all of this leading to upregulation of the cytokines, especially tumor necrosis factor. And all of this will initiate different pathologists, which initiate secondary myocardial damage, either by left ventricular remodeling or contractile dysfunction, or even hypertrophy or apoptosis, enhancing more fibrosis, and this cytokine upregulation associated with excessive production of nitric oxide and oxygen free radical, and the subsequently electrophysiological changes. Based on this neurohormonal changes and the activation of the endothelin and its vasoconstriction effect, and the imbalance of between nitric oxide and this vasoconstrictive substance leading to structural change in the microcirculation and enhancing more damage of the tissue, all of this leading to progressive pump failure and more aggravation of the symptoms of heart failure, and it may progress to sudden death or fatal arrhythmia. While the perfusion based is acting on ischemia, as once we have a systolic dysfunction, mean that there is low cardiac output with lack of systemic perfusion with hypotension, and all of this integrated with each other through systemic vasoconstriction and the lack of coronary perfusion, which enhance more ischemia at the level of the myocardium and tissue anoxia all over the body. Also for the diastolic dysfunction, in which there is lack of relaxation of the left ventricle, which is associated with significant increase in the left ventricular end diastolic pressure, with evidence of pulmonary congestion interfering with the proper oxygenation and ventilation, and this is will be reflected by significant hypoxemia, which lead to significant drop in the oxygen delivery to the tissue, and the final will be ischemia, which is leading to progressive myocardial damage and dysfunction and progressive deterioration in the general condition, and finally leading to death and deterioration of the ventricular function. That's why, based on this pathophysiology and due to this progressive nature of heart failure, we cannot say that patient being stable, and usually this patient presented by acute exacerbation every now and then. And we have to know that the frequency of decompensation and the risk of mortality increases with acute events, and sudden deaths occur at any time, as progressively this type of patient, due to progressive disease or progressive syndrome of acute decompensation of heart failure, the cardiac function is progressively declining with time, and the patient required frequent hospitalization at many time with declining of his ventricular function, and this is leading the secondary to progression of the disease with significantly increasing in the mortality by time. And the heart failure with reduced ejection fraction is characterized by frequent hospitalization, and this is significantly linked to mortality, which ranging between 4 to 50% according to the time of being admitted and the frequency to the heart. As worsening of heart failure symptom increase the risk of morbidity and mortality. Worsening of heart failure symptoms and sign that result in hospital admission increases the risk for readmission and death, which increases 6 times greater risk of all cause of mortality for patients whose symptom required a heart failure hospitalization, and 5 times greater risk of all mortality in patient with worsening heart failure symptoms. Also, it is clear there is a relationship between lower left ventricular ejection fraction and the cardiovascular outcome or morbidity outcome or mortality outcome. Once we have a significant low ejection fraction, we have higher stroke incidence, fatal myocardial infarction, heart failure to the, leading to this due to lack of perfusion or lethal arrhythmia, or sudden cardiac death, which mostly due to arrhythmogenic insult, or even non-cardiovascular cause of this, all of it increasing with a significant drop of the ejection fraction compared to the normal ejection fraction patients. How to diagnose heart failure? This is, I put here, I think all of us are familiar with this color, the green, the yellow, the orange and the red, and this is, had been inferred from the European Society and also from the Saudi Society of Cardiology after it make some sort of mitigation and overlap between the American and European Society. So for simplified, we consider this green represent when you see it, so it means this is highly recommended, and in the yellow means should be considered, and in orange it may be considered, while if you see a red flag, this means it is not recommended. First of all, the clinical assessment and the clinical examination. We recommend that choice of investigations should be first be guided by careful history and physical examination, and when clinical evidence suggests a possible cause and a bland test or tests result would be reasonably expected to lead to a change in the clinical care and management. This is very important. And the applied diagnostic measures for any patient who's admitted by symptoms suggestive of heart failure, including the presentation by shortness of breath, the history of cardiovascular disease, and based on the history of presentation. So initial assessment by natriuretic peptide, plasma natriuretic peptide, when it is significantly high, it means this is cardiac issue. If it is low, this mean or normal, this excluding cardiac cause. And the time of admission, the patient should be exposed to a diagnostic test, which including 12-lead ECG, chest X-ray, and 4 laboratory profiles, including cardiac markers, which is troponin, thyroid profile, liver profile, kidney profile, and the most important is the echocardiography, as we are going to discuss it in full detail in the next few slides. Here, this is just for simplification of the diagnostic approach for any patient who had presentation suspected of heart failure. Initial taking proper history and perform proper clinical examination. This is very important. Then the initial workup to send a lab of natriuretic peptide plus doing an ECG and doing chest X-ray with full lab profile. If we have BNP or natriuretic peptide isn't normal, so this is unlikely to be heart failure. If we found it is an abnormal with an ECG, so we have to go for the next step is to do an imaging by echo ultrasound, by utilizing the ultrasound for doing echo for the heart and ultrasound for the chest and the assessment of the inferior vena cava. Based if it is found that the picture is abnormal, so heart failure is confirmed. Based on this data, I have to determine the etiology and start appropriate way of treatment and management. And this is very crucial and very put in consideration that there is non-cardiac cause for elevation of the natriuretic peptide, including sepsis, anemia, renal failure, old age, and significant pulmonary disease or any critical illness. So the trend or the pattern of elevation of the natriuretic peptide is a very important and crucial during handling and managing and diagnosis of heart failure. The use of focused cardiac ultrasound has growing tremendously over the recent years and is increasingly being performed and interpreted by critical care intensivists and anesthesiologists and even the emergency medicine physician. This tool should be in the hand of every person dealing with critically ill patient. This imaging technique is so useful in establishing the etiology of the cardiac dysfunction and should be complement the physical examination and the standard of hemodynamic monitor by means the ultrasound utilization is a part of the physical examination and should be practiced with the standard hemodynamic monitoring and management. The echocardiography is so important and we are going to discuss. It has a diagnostic and it has a therapeutic implications. The utilization of echocardiography and the imaging of the lung and the use focused cardiac ultrasound modules is so important in managing of the patient. And many literature had been raised that the cardiothoracic ultrasound guided therapy for patient with acute heart failure resulted in better, greater decongestion during shorter period of time. This is without any increased adverse event in this small pattern of patient had been studied in different centers and it had been associated with better post-discharge prognosis and even it minimizing tissue injury or iatrogenic deterioration of different organ function by overdiuresis and minimizing iatrogenic problem that happened from improper way of treatment. Through utilization of focused ultrasound or cardiothoracic ultrasound imaging for the patient who present, we can evaluate the volume status through utilization of the medical EE prime ratio, evaluation of the IVC, assessment of the lung ultrasound to exactly identify the cause of dyspnea. Is it due to excessive lung water? Is it due to effusion, collapse, consolidation, infiltration? And the IBOI assessment for the left ventricle or the right ventricle and pericardium help you to reach the diagnosis. And finally, utilizing the measures to check the VTI is very crucial and we're going to discuss it in detail in the next few slides. The focused echo exam In the cardiothoracic ultrasound protocol or focused ultrasound evaluating the cardiac filling pressure, including EA prime ratio, and we have the cut point between either above or below 15. And we have five classes for measurement of inferior vena cava, plus the respiratory variation, and these indices had been plotted against each other to scale the IVC measurement to grade 1 to grade 5. Grade 1, which representing slit-like, narrow, collapsible inferior vena cava with significant collapsibility during the respiration, denoting that the patient is on the hypovolemic side. While in grade 5, mean that the maximum diameter is more than 21 millimeter with no respiratory variation of the hepatic vein. This is very important, crucial point during assessment of the volume status and even in the assessment of the decongestion pattern and way of treatment for the patient presented by decompensated acute heart failure. Also, in a lag or if any contraindication to utilize invasive hemodynamic monitoring, like checking the central venous pressure, we can know the right atrial pressure through matching the collapsibility index of the IVC and the maximum diameter. It can give us a clue about the range of the CVP or the right atrial pressure. For the lung ultrasound, which is highly recommended, the lung ultrasound should be considered for a confirmation, as we said before. Is it pulmonary congestion or pleural effusion? The lung ultrasound should be differentiate different form of respiratory causes of dyspnea. And it could be due to parenchymatous lung disease like IBF or ARDS, could be pneumothorax, could be pleural effusion, could be cardiogenic pulmonary edema. And the lung ultrasound is more sensitive in comparison to the X-ray, especially in detection of the lung consolidation, especially if done in mechanically ventilated patients. This pattern or this slide, it present how the lung normal ultrasound it showed with this A line, which is transverse line, which had been lost once there is a starting accumulation of water inside the lung. The examination of the lung is done through this different area, the midclavicular line, the supra and the inframammary area, and just imaging of this area correlating, comparing to each other. If you found it bilaterally, there is fanning line or B line, more than 3 to 5 B lines, denoting there is extensive lung water, which is secondary to the pulmonary congestion. Also, moving the transducer to the mid axillary or posterior axillary line in conjunction to see the cobula of the diaphragm with the liver down and the lung up, while the facing the knob of the transducer toward the patient head in perpendicular pattern, you can see if there is any fluid collection or any other consolidation in this area. And moving to the midline or paramidline, you can see how is the IVC shifting to the apex and to assess the cardiac structure, as we're going to discuss it later, and assessment of the EE prime ratio through utilizing the pulsed Doppler wave over the mitral valve and tissue Doppler over the medial aspect of the mitral annulus, we can identify the EE prime ratio. So accumulating the EE prime plus the IVC, it can give you a clue or a measurement about the volume status or the preload of the heart. Also, the lung ultrasound, it give you beneficial data concerning the presence of consolidation. If you see here the pattern or the difference between the V lines and the consolidation, which is more confluent and more adherent, and sometimes it appears like a consolidation. As it is apparent here, there is a significant consolidation, and if you match it, this shape of this area of the lung, it will be looks like a liver. And this is the view of evidence of the B-lines and pulmonary congestion, and here the area of hypoechoic pleural effusion, when we see it here with the liver down and the diaphragm in between. So ultrasound is a very dedicated procedure, help in diagnosis and help to manage and to titrate your treatment substrates. Also, utilization for the Doppler and the echocardiography for assessment of the VTI. This is very important, especially in patient with heart failure with reduced ejection fraction. Once you diagnose it, assessment of the left ventricular outflow tract velocity time integral. And when we assess it through the five chamber view, when you put the pulse Doppler in alignment with the flow of the aortic valve, you can assess for VTI. And the extremely low VTI, it is strongly predictable for the adverse outcome and identify the patient who may benefit from advanced heart failure therapy. Also, the low VTI is an easily available non-invasive tool to identify the patient who are at risk and the patient who may benefit from further intervention and advanced therapy for heart failure. Then patient with heart failure with preserved ejection fraction, the VTI can offer a very good prognostic factors. As in this study, they found that the cutoff of the VTI either below or above 15.8, and they concluded that low admission VTI was an independent determinant of worse clinical outcome in a hospitalized patient with heart failure with preserved ejection fraction, indicating that low VTI on admission might be useful categorizing a low flow heart failure preserved ejection fraction phenotype and risk stratification in the hospitalized this type of patient in the ICU. Finally, and this slide, I just put it just to make the pictures clear. By eyeball assessment of this one, we can see all the wall is moving, proper thickening of the myocardium, good excursion of post mitral leaflet, free wall contracting very well, and there's a synchrony between the atrium and ventricular, and the synchrony between each part of the myocardium moving with each other in a synchronized pattern, squeezing pattern with both sides of atrium. So this is the normal picture. If we compare this to this one above, where there is a ballooning of the left ventricle with a significantly increase in the longitudinal dimension of the left atrium with a relatively normal right side. Here, there is globally hypokinesia, and indirectly by eyeball looking, it looks like that this mitral is the limited excursion. It is related to low cardiac output and increase in the left ventricular end diastolic pressure. And look here, there is significant thinning of the wall of the myocardium and there is lack of thickening. This means that this global hypokinesia and thickening can put you a diagnosis of ischemic or idiopathic cardiomyopathy, and it can put in the category of heart failure with reduced ejection fraction. While if you have a look here, see how the wall is very thick and how the cavity is so small, and this is short axis view taking at the mid of the left ventricle. There is a small rim of effusion and the contractility looks fine. But if you take this picture in four chamber view and you check the mitral flow, definitely you will find this patient had a restrictive flow over the mitral valve secondary to restrictive heart failure or heart failure secondary to diastolic dysfunction. And this is spot diagnosis once you just put the probe either to the apex or in the parastinal area. Other retrieving data from imaging of by the echocardiography is you can measure the cardiac output by a non-invasive procedure through assessment of the left ventricular outflow tract diameter and the assessment of the VTI, stroke volume can be calculated, area time distance. And this stroke volume, if it is multiplied by heart rate, we can infer here the cardiac output. So by simple non-invasive tools and management, we can reach to proper diagnosis, proper assessment, and we can tailor the way of management and treatment for this type of critical. Finally, this is an algorithm to wrap all the bus data. So we have all to start by history taking and the physical examination for this type of patient to see if there is sign or symptom of heart failure. Next step to check even in the ER, go for BNB. And the proBNP, if it came to be negative, so we can consider other diagnosis. If we don't find and we are not convinced, so go for echocardiography either to prove it or to disprove it. If the patient came to be proBNP or BNP is negative, so this means that this patient is already of cardiac origin and we have to do some investigation which is required, like assessing the troponin to know if it is this heart failure in a sequence of coronary artery disease and assess other organ function for better management and treating of other precipitating factors. Acute heart failure therapeutic tool and concepts. The timeline of acute heart failure therapy, which had been progressed in the last years, as it is since pre-1980, the treatment was so primitive, and sometimes it was just bed rest, giving some mercurial diuretics, this in 70s or early 80s, and which have been changed to the loop diuretics, and giving the patient one tablet of drugs, and that's it. And over years, it came more advancement in the management of heart failure, reached to the devices, including the CRT, ICD, and left ventricular assisted device, and even heart transplant, and now in the era of gene therapy and cellular modification. The goal of treatment of acute heart failure, three goals we have to put it in consideration. The immediate one is to improve the hemodynamic and the organ perfusion, is to restore proper oxygenation to maintain oxygen delivery and maintain good oxygen carrying capacity, is to elevate the symptom of patient he is going to be presented and to limit organ damage and especially renal damage, and to prevent thromboembolization and minimize, this is very important, we have to minimize the ICU length of stay. For the intermediate care and goal of treatment is to identify the etiology and the relevant comorbidity and to titrate the therapy to control the symptom and the congestion and optimize the blood pressure and consider device therapy if it is inappropriate and to prepare the patient for pre-discharge and long-term management plan through initiation of drugs which modify the course of therapy and to titrate it up, especially the pharmacological therapy for modifying medication that we can call it a prognostic, including ACE inhibitor, beta blocker, RNA receptor blocker, which is called sacubitril, and all this is we are going to discuss in the next few slides. There is a rationale that everybody had to consider it during management of patient with heart failure. As both societies, European and American, they underscored that similarly to acute coronary syndrome, acute heart failure might benefit from time to therapy concept. By other term, time is equal life. Early prediction and identify the precipitating factor and the specific phenotype of this heart failure, it's clear. Early intervention by mean to treat and to diagnose. These two arms should be running parallel to each other. And pharmacological therapy to counteract this neurohormonal action changes with aggressive management that should be perfusion-directed therapy guided with dedicated meticulous monitoring. And monitoring here is very crucial, especially the hemodynamic profile by invasive and non-invasive measures, the assessment of the pulmonary function, renal profile, neuropsychiatric status, hematological status, assessment of presence or absence of sepsis and infection and other comorbidities, and to manage any associated problem. All of this considering that heart failure is a multidisciplinary approach is important in acute heart failure, which can be caused or aggravated by both cardiac and non-cardiac. The recommendation for management of acute heart failure started by the oxygen therapy and ventilatory support, and this is so critical and so crucial for everybody to know. Supplementation of oxygen, it is not a luxury. Supplementation of oxygen is to maintain proper oxygen delivery and to counteract the secondary pathological changes which had been happening in the lung due to significant congestion, which interfering with the proper function of the pulmonary system to provide proper oxygenation. So monitoring of the saturation is so important. Measurement of the blood gases and the blood pH, carbon dioxide, assessment of serum lactate and lactate clearance is very important. Venous blood gases, this is a very important, especially in patient with cardiac decompensation or cardiogenic shock. The oxygen supplementation is a must in order to maintain saturation above 90 and keeping the saturation, the PO2 more than 60. And to correct this hypoxemia. If it is failed, so I have to go for non-invasive ventilation. If we failed, we have to go to the intubation. And we're going to discuss this issue. But in consideration, this arterial gases is very crucial as acidosis is very harmful. There is a link, a significant link between acidosis and mortality on general, and there is significant relation between acidosis and between 30 days to 12 months mortality on all the acidotic patients due to any causes, respiratory, metabolic, or combined. Acidosis is a killing for a patient with heart failure. And venous blood or central venous oxygen saturation is a very crucial, very important items to be followed and to be monitored in a plus lactate clearance. The arteriovenous oxygen saturation gradient, we call it, the normal difference between the arterial and venous oxygen saturation between 15 to 20, this equivalent to the extraction. If the extraction is increasing and the gradient is increasing by mean lower SVO2, mean the patient is in a bad shape, especially if the patient started to have significant rise of serum lactate. The central venous oxygen saturation is a balance between the oxygen delivery and the oxygen consumption. In many studies, they found that in decompensated heart failure, especially this type of patient who requiring anatropic support, they have significant improvement in the central venous oxygen saturation when they reached up to 60 within around 24 hours. And this was correlated not with the cardiac output exactly, but it's correlated to the parameter that revealing that the patient started to be decongested, which is the vena cava diameter and the respiratory variation in response to the respiration. And also, it is correlated to the amount of urine had been voted in response to improvement of the hemodynamics and utilization of the diuretics. This is very important. In this slides, we have here a clear correlation between cardiac output. Once it is increasing, the SVO2 is increasing. And once it is dropping down, the SVO start to decrease. So, put in mind, arterial blood gas is a must, acidosis is a killing, SVO2 is a must, higher reading indicating good status, but put in consideration, higher reading with narrowing of the extraction scale or narrow arteriovenous gradient, this is maybe happen, especially with sepsis, which should be considered. We have a combined cases. I don't want to confuse the people. So isolated case of heart failure, there is widening of the gap between the arterial venous. It is, once you have extraction maximum, it is compensated. If lactate is increasing, this is carry very bad poor prognosis. So all these points should be considered, put in mind. A non-invasive ventilation at this moment, when you found that everything is going toward the anoxia, ischemia, and anaerobic metabolism, consider BiPAP or CPAP. The positive pressure ventilation had a very beneficial effect on the cardiovascular and the respiratory, in spite that it may lead to a little bit hypertension if the utilizing pressure is high. But it lead to decrease the left ventricular afterload and increase the systolic wall stress on the left ventricle. And in its turn, in spite it may decrease the cardiac output, but the total beneficial effect is equivalent to this reduction of cardiac output when you use proper pressure. And the benefit coming from proper oxygenation and optimization of the oxygen carrying capacity and proper recruitment of the lung and villi and increasing the functional residual capacity of the lung. Also decreasing work of breathing and better oxygenation with saving of the cardiac output to the vital organ like kidney, brain, and liver. And all of this carry a very beneficial effect for the patient with acute decompensation. Which of which to be utilized? CPAP or BiPAP? It depends on the patient tolerability, but BiPAP it's more physiological because you have two pressure, I and E pressure. So it's more physiological, allowing patient to be more convenient, more comfort during implementing this BiPAP, especially if you had a combined lung disease. The practical based classification of heart failure, we have to know exactly this, the classification based on either precipitating or the triggering factor or causes that may cause decompensation, which have very specific treatment and need to be corrected urgently. As we see in this table, the factor that trigger acute heart failure, which is correctable, this is associated with significant changes in the patient profile. If we have a coronary, acute coronary artery disease and it is significantly improved by intervention or any surgical intervention by revascularization, this will solve a lot of problems. Tachyarrhythmia, either managed by cardioversion or by drugs, would revert the situation. If we had significant high blood pressure, if we have superadded infection, if the patient is not adherent to the medication, we have salt overload, bradyarrhythmia. If the patient is had some exacerbation due to chronic obstructive pulmonary airway disease or all this the precipitating factor, if it is correctable, once you correct it, the patient will respond well. But if you don't have of any of these reversible factors, mean you are stuck because you are dealing with an end stage heart failure and he coming in a late situation. So we like to see a precipitating factor because we know that handling of this precipitating factor, we will relieve the patient and the patient may still have some reserve to be persistent and going and improving every now and then. According to the clinical assessment, the classification to check if the patient is on the dry side or in the wet side, or patient is perfused or not perfused. So we have a four category classification, either to be warm or dry, or warm or wet, or cold, dry, or cold and wet. So based on the congestion, if the patient is at significant pulmonary congestion by signs of increased GVB, hepatojugular reflex, ascites, lower limb edema, history or physical examination, history showed paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea and orthopnea, all this within indicating this patient is on the congested side or wet side. Or the patient is decongested or just not congested. So this four category will invite us to a specific way of here, once we receive the patient of acute heart failure and we start to tailor our way of management or plan, we have to evaluate this patient with acute heart failure to do bedside assessment including all the BAST parameter plus the hemodynamic profile. And the clinical examination will answer the presence of congestion. But in consideration that 95% of all patients with heart failure are of the congested type, and 5% only came to be dry. The congested or wet type, we have to re-evaluate for the presence of perfusion. If we found that this patient is perfused, so we can consider him the wet and warm patient, mean WW patient, which is typically elevated with normal systolic blood pressure. This patient can be either of a vascular type, where the fluid accumulation intravascularly and the main domination is the hypertension. So this problem can be sorted by vasodilators and diuretics. Other patient, which is a cardiac type fluid accumulation, it's mean this patient is start to be bloated and edematous. So diuretics and vasodilator and even ultrafiltration in case of diuretic resistance is a must. If the perfusion in this the wet patient is defective, and we call it this patient is wet but he's hypoperfused, we have to check his blood pressure. If the systolic blood pressure less than 90, systolic blood pressure is less than 90 in a wet cold patient, so we have to consider inotropic support plus vasopressor. And the check if there is response to diuretics, and when we started to perfuse and maintain the blood pressure. And I think this type of patient, he is in the patient who may require mechanical circulatory support, and he may require to proceed for ultrafiltration or CVVHD ultrafiltration. In another types of this 5%, the patient is dry. If he is dry and perfused, and this is very rare to see him in the critical care area, this is need just to adjust him to his oral medication. But if he is dry and cold and he is hypoperfused, he's mean in the hypovolemic. So consider fluid challenge. And this fluid challenge is very crucial, because fluid challenge, sometimes you have to consider to add inotropic supports to be able to get this fluid challenge for the patient in order to maintain proper perfusion. And to me, the patient could be able to tolerate this small amount of volume just to reach him to the normal profile. This another diagram to tell you how to interfere with the case of acute heart failure in another way of thinking. This is the have to go by urgent phase, and you have to go by an immediate phase. The urgent phase is in 1 hour and first day management. In 1 hour, initially the patient is admitted, is diagnosed as acute decompensated heart failure, presented by respiratory symptoms with evidence of congestion, and that patient should be symptomatically treated. So consider symptomatic treatment. By other means, consider inotropes vasopressor based on the perfusion profile. Based on the oxygenation, consider non-invasive or invasive ventilation. And if the congestion is a dominating factor, so consider diuretics or ultrafiltration. And after stabilization and settlement of this patient, we have to identify this precipitating factor. And this is the most important acute coronary syndrome to deal with him based on the guidelines, either through medication or revascularization. If the main factor is arrhythmia, so you have to go by cardioversion or electrically or medical. I think in unstable patient, you have to go for electrical cardioversion. In a relatively stable patient, you can go medically. The acute pulmonary embolism, which is an precipitating factor, we have to manage it and to treat as the presentation. How is it? And infection should be treated by proper antibiotics according to the guidelines and the recommendation. And within the first week, we have to do 3 things. Monitoring, initiation, discharge criteria. Monitoring for the patient to see the efficacy of treatment through weighting the patient, measuring blood pressure, measuring heart rate, managing complication, providing vital organ stable, and check for any the ECG or echocardiographic abnormality. And monitoring initiation of drugs that have a prognostic factors. with drugs which had significant influence on the outcome, and started a multidisciplinary care, started patient education and put a plan how frequent the patient and to start the medication and when to discharge. And once you reach to the discharge criteria, when the patient started to be decongested, stable, and reached a stage that he can take most of his oral therapy for heart failure, then the patient can be discharged from the hospital. As all of us are familiar with utilization of diuretics in heart failure, and I will not add too much in this section, all of us know the tools how to start diuretics. The dose is usually is frequently open, but usually we consider it 2.5 times than the usual dose patient present on it while he's in the chronic status. And we have to consider the adding of thiazide plus loop diuretics, especially if the patient is considered a diuretic resistance. And this is take a very important issue, which is the diuretic resistance considerations. This is a very common practical problem we face it during management of a patient with heart failure. The most important and the most common, and the category is mainly prerenal. We have a prerenal and intrarenal causes of the diuretic resistance consideration. The prerenal, the most important, is related to the venous congestion. The resistance of venous congestion and the high venous pressure is one of the leading cause of the diuretic resistance. This is number one. Number two, increasing intra-abdominal pressure by accumulating ascites, and the venous congestion also is another factor that interfering with renal perfusion and urine output. Also, a very important point is a low cardiac output. So don't consider blood pressure as a main factor. The urine output could be sluggish even with the blood pressure is above 90 over 60, because you have to combine the hemodynamic basal with each other. The blood pressure is one factor, but if it is not providing a sufficient cardiac output, so you have to consider initiation of inotropes, other modalities, or even sometimes you have to interfere externally by doing ultrafiltration to relieve all this type of venous congestion and this accumulation of fluid, either by tapping or whatever, to counteract this prerenal cause, or to start this patient on inotropic support to maintain better perfusing pressure to provide proper kidney and urine output. Also, hypoalbuminemia with high salt intake, all of this represented a prerenal cause. And the intrarenal, I will focus only mainly on the pre-loop of Hennel, which is related to the reduction of the GFR due to glomerulopathy diseases related to the diabetes, hypertension, and the chronic hypoperfusion, or what we call it cardiorenal syndrome, and sometimes also hypoalbuminemia working in that. Other factors which is correctable and sometimes being missing is the hypochloremic metabolic alkalosis. The hypochloremic metabolic alkalosis is a common feature that we saw in patient with chronic use of diuretics. So don't forget to check the chloride and to check the bicarb matched with the pH. If you found it in the site of hypochloremic metabolic alkalosis, you have to correct it just to have a good response and out of this diuretic. The vasodilators, inotropic support, vasopressor, thromboembolic prophylaxis, all of this is very important point for being discussed by the guidelines. And the dilemma of the support is one of the main issues. Vasopressor inotrope selection, this is a matter of discussion of all physicians. The practical recommendation for the use of inotropes in patients with acute heart failure. Let's consider that this acute heart failure patient is hypoperfused. So hypoperfusion is not, as I said again, and I repeated many times, hypoperfusion is not blood pressure. Hypoperfusion can happen while the patient has a systolic blood pressure is above 90. So you have to consider a vasodilator. And in this type of patient, if I'm sure that this patient had high heart failure with reduced ejection fraction, I will go directly to vasodilator inotropes, which is phosphodiesterases like Myrinone, or sometimes utilizing dobutamine if the patient is less arrhythmogenic. So going by vasodilator and check for the clinical establishment. If the patient clinically stabilized, it's okay. If no, consider inotropes. And the clinical stabilization have to check. If he has not, so consider other intervention by mechanical circulatory device. Other patient which came with a low blood pressure and lack of perfusion from the start, consider inotropic support plus or minus vasopressors. And till the clinical stabilization, this patient should be shifted. If he stabilized, will be transitioned to the chronic heart failure. If he's not, we have to go to the mechanically circulatory support. There is commonly encountered concomitant condition in which the acute heart failure patient are corresponding inotropic of a choice. Like, if we have hypotension, I think this hypotension per se, we can open all domain if this is isolated. If you, according to the clinical response, selection between nor epinephrine, dobutamine, or dopamine. If we the patient had overdose of beta blocker, so consider Myrinone. Levosimendan is not approved in Saudi Arabia. If secondary to pulmonary hypertension, Myrinone is of a choice. If you had acute cardiorenal syndrome, dopamine and dobutamine is of a choice. If is it heart failure in a sequence of ischemic etiology, dobutamine is a good option, and I think Myrinone also, for me, it looks a good option. If it is the heart failure within a sequence of cardiopulmonary bypass, Myrinone is of a choice, maybe plus or minus dobutamine according to the presence of arrhythmia. If a sepsis is present, so norepinephrine is a must to start plus or minus dobutamine. The renal replacement therapy in patient with acute heart failure is a must if the patient showed lack of response and persistency of lack of response to diuretics with evidence of significant congestion and increased venous congestion and accumulating fluid in all parts of the body. So CR ultrafiltration or CRRT renal replacement therapy is a must, especially if acute kidney injury is an inciting factor. Here, the recommendation for oral evidence-based disease-modifying therapies in patient with acute heart failure. The recommendation listed that in patient with reduced ejection fraction, once had been stabilized, we can start and resume this evidence-based disease-modifying therapy. What is this? This is including the ACE inhibitors or ARBs, beta blocker, mineralocorticoid antagonist, and RNA receptor blocker. And this is a new one, which is sacubitril. Or this is in the market, they call it Interesto. So this diagram, which showed here, this type of patient presented in acute stage, that including this red flag area. This is the early acute phase, which is the maximum deterioration at the time of admission. And according to the trajectory, the patient will pass in either way. Or the patient showed significant improvement toward the target that we need. Or the patient went to stale pathway. All the patients show progressive deterioration and worsening, and he will have progressive deterioration and continue in the manner of refractory heart failure. The patient who had improving and reached toward the target, what target? Target is that no congestion, proper perfusion, proper organ function, more stabilization, proper breathing, patient reached to the normovolemic status or a dry status. So at this point, we call the area of transition to oral therapy. So during the patient's admission in the critical care area, the oral medication should be started at this zone and titrated and gradually titrated till we reach to the optimization zone. and to start this by early post-discharge phase. So at this point, we'll discharge the patient. So here we started during his course of admission in the ICU, till we reach the optimizing state, and the patient will get settled, he's okay. What is the value to start this type of medication? The value of this guideline-directed medical therapy, it does this modifying treatment or oral medication. First of all, it will significantly improve the patient clinical condition. This is number one. Two, it will prevent readmission. And this is very important. It's very bad to discharge 5 or 6 patients with heart failure to the cardiac ward, and after 2 or 3 days, you have consequently, one after each other, had to come back again to be readmitted. Especially in the era of COVID-19, our scope of thinking should be directed to a short time of admission that had to be vigorous aggressive management in short period of time, and have to minimize the risk for readmission. That's why, with the utilization of diuretics by the mean that we mentioned, and optimization of the dose of diuretics, and monitoring and assessing for the how the patient is being diuresed, how the response, assessment by all the imaging technique, and the patient started to be had a probable blood pressure, electrolyte panel is maintained, reached to the target. And once the target is achieved, means that this patient is adequate decongestion and started to be hemodynamically stable and there is no complication. So I have to continue this type of treatment and starting the patient on the medication, which had a very significant influence on the patient course. This is type of management is specified for heart failure patient with reduced ejection fraction. So ACE inhibitor or ARBs or beta blocker, this is as one box, and we check for the symptom if he's appropriately improved. If not, we can combine beta blocker and mineralocorticoid receptor antagonist, and we have to remove ACE inhibitor and to start this sacubitril valsartan plus or minus mineralocorticoid receptor antagonist and titrating the dose. Usually we start it by 50 milligrams. The usual dose is 100 milligram BID. Usually we titrate, reach it by 50 milligram once. Once the patient stopped his IV diuretics and shifted to the oral lasix. So going by 50 milligram, titrating the dose based on renal profile, blood pressure, urine output, and the clinical status of the patient till we reach to the maximum tolerated dose, which is 100 BID. Sometimes we need more time to reach. Another issue is the heart rate. If the heart rate is still persistently above the 70, in spite that we're utilizing beta blocker, so we can go to the irbesartan, which is the controlling. We have to go to evobridine to control his heart rate and to come down by heart rate to below 70 based on the guidelines. And this is an update about the angiotensin nebrilicin inhibitor in acute decompensated heart failure. And this had been published in 2019. They are discussing the implementation and the initiation of the sacubitril. This in Pioneer study, which had been sponsored by Novartis. And they came with a very strong evidence that there is a significant decrease and drop in the proline B for the patient follow-up in comparison to the patient under control by ACE inhibitors. This will list the standard of care for all the patients who was presented by acute heart failure. I will go through fast the standard invasive monitoring of heart rate, rhythm, respiratory rate, oxygen saturation, blood pressure. And it's recommended also for the patient to be weighted daily, recommended to evaluate signs, symptoms of relevant heart failure, and to frequent do daily measurement of renal profile and electrolytes, and intra-arterial line insertion is a must, especially in decompensated patient. And I want to just to figure here that still there is a room for a pulmonary articaster. I am from a lover for this swine glands. The pulmonary articaster may be considered in a patient who, despite pharmacological treatment, persistent refractory heart failure symptoms, and this patient still persistently hyperperfused and in shock state. The last part for our discussion, it will be the cardiogenic shock. I will give small updates about the cardiogenic shock as a part of acute heart failure. The different definition for the cardiogenic shock, we can define as inadequate tissue perfusion resulted from cardiac dysfunction, or we can define as decreased cardiac output and tissue hypoxemia in the presence of adequate intravascular volume, or we can define it by hemodynamic definition, which is sustained systolic, sustained drop of the systolic blood pressure less than 90 with a cardiac index less than 2.2 with a pulmonary capillary wedge pressure more than 15. Cardiogenic shock continue to be the leading cause of death in patients with acute myocardial infarction. Despite implementation of the guidelines recommended early revascularization, mortality rate of acute myocardial infarction complicated by cardiogenic shock remain a constant at about 50%. Given the about 60,000 patients with acute myocardial infarction complicated cardiogenic shock every year, there is an urgent need for treatment strategy that might improve the outcome in this type of patients. Three major steps improving the survival in acute myocardial infarction cardiogenic shock. First, early recognition and rapid triage of patient with cardiogenic shock to a cardiac catheterization laboratory. Two, initiation of mechanical circulatory support device prior to the BCI with door to support time less than 90 minutes. Consistent use of invasive hemodynamic monitoring to guide weaning and or escalation of care. In accordance with the currently available best practice, a care pathway for a management of acute myocardial infarction cardiogenic shock. Early recognition of cardiogenic shock to enable transfer the patient to a shock care center with first medical contact to support less than or equal 90 minutes. Transfer the patient directly to a level 1 cardiogenic shock center with a BCI facility, availability of advanced mechanical circulatory support 24 hours per 7 days, and the multidisciplinary cardiogenic shock team, including on-site invasive cardiologist, cardiac critical care facility, and cardiothoracic surgeon. Rapid initiation of mechanical circulatory support devices should be favored over inotropic support that may be used initially, as escalating dose of inotropics are so detrimental to the cardiac recovery. Hypothermia with target temperature management in patient with out of hospital cardiac arrest and cardiogenic shock who have achieved ROS criterion of spontaneous circulation. Initiation of the hemodynamics with an ambilibrate to BCI of the culprit lesions only with the goal of achieving both in 90 minutes, as every 10 minutes of treatment delay in acute myocardial infarction cardiogenic shock result in 3.3 additional deaths per every 100 patients. Hemodynamic assessment with right heart catheterization, which is the Swan Ganz, after BCI for better optimization of hemodynamic indices. Escalation and de-escalation of hemodynamic support based on the clinical course of the patient to escalate or de-escalate of care. This graph It including the care pathway algorithm for the patient who been presented by cardiogenic shock. So either the patient presented by cardiogenic shock or post-cardiac arrest. The one who came post-cardiac arrest, if his return ROSC is achieved or if he's not achieved, or patient started to have extracorporeal circulatory support, this patient should go directly to therapeutic hypothermia and shift it to cardiac shock center, which is a level 1. If we have a cardiac center or shock center level 2, the patient with cardiogenic shock had been presented directly to it with the facility to do umbrella, and if it is available, and the carpet vessels have been opened by BCI with right side catheterization to evaluate the shock state plus or minus inotropes. If you reach it to this stage, shift this patient directly to the level 1. Also, for the patient coming to non-BCI center, stabilization first, and initial management, and even thrombolysis, and give the patient shifted to the cardiac shock center level 1. And the time to transfer should be very short. Based on the here in this assessment, we have to check if the patient is still hypotension, to assess the LV dysfunction by evidence and increase in the aortic ventricular end diastolic pressure with invasive hemodynamic monitoring showing that the index is less than 2.2, right side heart catheterization post BCI to evaluate the shock indices. If we found, and during this procedure of hypothermia, of the hypotension evaluation, umbrella or tandem heart could be initiated and doing with BCI. If this patient still had this biventricular dysfunction, the evidence of cardiogenic shock with evidence of tissue hypoperfusion, lactic acidosis, starting multi-organ dysfunction, so go directly to veno-arterial extracorporeal membrane oxygenation or tandem heart. And this is according to the availability of these tools and the mechanical circulatory support device. If the patient had good function or acceptable hemodynamic profile, but is still in refractory hypoxemia due to shock lung or lung injury, so go directly to veno-arterial ECMO in the same manner, or as this is will provide maximum support. And put in consideration, this is very important, utilization of ECMO in patient post cardiogenic shock secondary to acute coronary syndrome, combination of ECMO and intra-aortic balloon counterpulsation is a must to counteract the ECMO-induced left ventricular injury. And this matter, we're going to discuss it later in another presentation, because ECMO is a must, but in this condition, it can harm. So intra-aortic balloon is important combination in this manner. And this is the evidence of guidelines. In spite that I will go through here in this red flag, they wrote it here clearly that intra-aortic balloon is not routinely recommended in cardiogenic. Agree. But if you are going to utilize ECMO, it is indicated. And this is very important and very crucial. Here, I have to give you a small notes about the left ventricular assisted device. I will not go in detail. The eligibility and the indication for left ventricular assisted device implementation. Patient who present more than 2 months of severe symptom despite optimum medical therapy, and that device therapy, and more than one of the following. If the ejection fraction less than 25, if the patient had 3 or more hospitalization in the previous 12 months without any obvious precipitating factor apart from end-stage heart failure, the patient being dependent on IV inotropic support or vasopressor, the patient started to have progressive end-organ dysfunction with worsening of renal and hepatic function due to severe reduced hypoperfusion, and the patient had not adequate filling pressure, which pressure is more than 20, with low blood pressure and cardiac index less than 2. This must, this patient, if he had, should be absence of right ventricular dysfunction and should be had a competent, good right side or tricuspid valve, no tricuspid valve regurgitation to have this left ventricular device. If he had RV dysfunction, so this patient will be a matter for by vet. And this is economically very high. we have to know all type of patient of heart failure, and mostly the patient post acute cardiogenic shock, post acute myocardial infarction. These are the one who is eligible for this left ventricular assisted device, because they will take long time to recover, and sometimes when we, with all intervention, the patient reached to be one or two of these items. So LVAD is a must to be utilized and to consider as a bridge for transplant and not a treatment. And this is very important point to be considered. I will say thank you, and I appreciating all of you for your time. I wish I have my add value for your knowledge, and I wish to have, and soon inshallah after resolution of this COVID pandemic, to have live meeting and to have more interactive session between us and you. And best of luck for everybody. I wish from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to keep us safe, and to keep our families, our communities, our countries, to keep the world safe. And best wishes for all of you. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.